All right, so K-Salam, behind the glass booth, we have a very special guest today, the one and only legendary mixing engineer and producer, recording engineer, and many other things, but legendary mixing engineer, Bob Howard, thank you for...
You're very kind, thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, you're welcome, you're welcome. So let's get right to it. So for some people who don't know, let's just focus on mixing engineer for this question. What you do when you're mixing. I feel like there's a lot of people actually, even people who are in the business, or I would say up-and-comers. In the most basic way possible, how could you describe what it is that you do when you're mixing a project or song?
I have a very short sentence that describes that, but I'll go to the long one first for people who don't know anything.
Okay.
I take all the elements that people have recorded and make them sound really, really good.
Okay.
That's the short form. Mixing is about musical balances, meaning that there are balances between instruments, how loud different instruments are in traditional settings and different genres that you gotta go for. You know, if you're doing a metal record, you can't have a hip hop kick drum because they don't do that. They do a different thing. So I put together the musical proportions and the tonal balances. And by tonal balances, I mean the naturally occurring frequency content of each instrument and how they work together in a complementary fashion. Yeah, that's the very short answer.
All right, cool, cool. So when someone's giving you, let's say a song or let's say a project actually, are you trying to look at what they gave you and you're just going to make it sound better? But you got to take it into some type of direction. Are you trying to take it the direction it's already going and polish it? Or are you saying, look, I know it's going to sound better if I take it this way?
No. My whole thing as a producer, as a mixer, everything else is you got to realize the artist and producer's vision. That's the most important thing. That's true north, you know. So I always ask them, you know, your rough mix that you're giving me, how close is that to what you want? And if they say, well, we really love it, we just want it to sound better, I say, don't give me your money because I don't want to redo what you've already done. But if they tell me, you know, sometimes they go, what? You know, what do you mean? But a lot of times they'll say, well, we like the direction, but the drums really need to pop, the vocals need to sound more muscular and more present, stuff like that. It's very, very important to me what the artist intended.
So if they give you something rough, you say, and they say, I just want it to sound better, you say,
then
no,
I do my no, then I do my thing. If they give me something rough and say, we really love the rough mix, I say, fine, save your money, pay me, I'll master that, and I'll make it sound a lot better. But if you want that thing, there's no sense in giving me thousands of dollars to just give you that thing again.
Okay.
It's kind of like, it's not an ego thing, it's just I'm trying to be real with people.
Yeah.
And I don't like just sitting somewhere collecting money for something I'm supposed to be actually helping people with. That's not cool.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, okay, so, but with that said, you are known amongst people who know music for having a certain sound. So how does that kind of conflicts a little bit with somebody saying, I want to take it this way. Obviously they're coming to you.
Let me interrupt
to take
you.
It a certain way.
I'm known for certain records I've done. And
correct.
People associate me with those records and my sound with those records. I've been mixing jazz records for Blue Note, for Don Was, you know.
Uh-huh.
So I do everything. You know, people who don't know me that well or who aren't in the business think, oh, he just mixes hip hop. I've had people ask me, like, have you ever mixed rock? It's like, I've been doing music for 45 years.
Uh-huh.
Longer, I can't believe that. But I mean, a lot of people come to me because of the hip hop and modern soul records that they know I've done. But I do all sorts of different kinds of things, and I like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah, yeah. But has that, so you, because you know the consumer, and even just in general, people, they put people in boxes. They're going to put artists in boxes, which is kind of, obviously a lot of artists don't like that, but it's a little bit more fair than an actual mixing engineer.
It's going to happen.
Has it hurt you at all? Have you ever stopped? Look, okay, you've done rock records,
it has,
but have you ever been like, I want to do Metallica records?
Of course it's hurt me, but you know what? I've been too busy to worry about it.
Gotcha.
You know?
Yeah.
I'm sure a lot of people think, oh no, we can't go to him because he does this kind of thing. Whatever. You know, I haven't really looked for work in 30 years, so it's cool.
Yeah, okay.
You know, like I said, it's been really nice. The last 5, 8, 10 years, I've been doing a fair amount of jazz records, which are really fun. Rock and soul records that are very guitar oriented, so all different kinds of things.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you ever had, okay, I would say from my, even just as a consumer, the early 2000s is when record labels, especially in hip hop, really did the copycat thing. It's always been, that's always been a record label thing, but I feel like it got it to a point. Have you ever had someone come to you and, hey, this is our new Tribe Called Quest sounding group, and we want you to, and you've been like, this is corny, I'm not touching it.
Okay, a couple of things. As a producer, more than as a mixer, because usually labels are smart enough not to say stuff like that out loud, even if they mean it.
They're not going to say it, but you know.
Yeah, but a lot of times people say, oh, I want my record to sound like an Al Green record. I'm sorry, man, you're not Al Green. Yeah. The reason Al Green records sound the way they do is because Al Green is Al Green.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just the sound, it's the whole package. It gives me an indication of, and I don't say that to anybody, but it gives me an indication of the sonic direction that they want to go. Over my career, so many times I've gotten stuff and it really wasn't happening, but somehow they thought if I made it sound like this or like that, somehow the record would be more happening. You know, a good record, a great record is a compelling performance of a great song. Mm-hmm. If you don't have those two things,
the mix isn't gonna do anything.
Yeah, and but everybody knows that. But they got, you know, once you have a couple $100,000 into something, you say, I can't let this drop. I gotta find a way to make this really great. You know, it's like additional production. I don't do that anymore. When I, you know, if somebody finishes a record and they go, would you do some additional production? That means the record's not happening and they want me to throw some shit at it until something happens.
Yeah.
And usually those things are, the foundation of the house is not there to begin with. And again, a compelling performance of a great song. Whether you like what he does or not, James Taylor could make a great record on a phone. And everybody kind of, you know, they might not listen to him all the time, but they go, oh yeah, James Taylor, he's cool. Biggie's the same way. You know, Biggie could read the phone book, could have read the phone book, and it would have been cool because he was Biggie.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And people lose sight of that, that the core of what's there has to be interesting and fascinating to people, because you can polish it up as much as you want. And that's been half my career. And it just wasn't that much substance there. Mm-hmm.
So you spoke on this additional production thing. For a lot of up-and-coming mixing engineers, how often are you doing something and you actually change the snare? And you're like, okay, this I'm mixing this, but this snare, this is a great song, but this snare is not working.
A lot of guys, a lot of the big rock guys have their own sample library, and they immediately sound replace the drums.
Guys as far as mixing engineers.
Yeah. I do whatever I have to do to make it sound really good. And right. Sometimes I'll sneak in other samples behind theirs to give it more punch and muscle. The snare drum is real interesting. You know, a lot of people feel like the sound of the snare drum really dictates the whole sound of the record. Mm-hmm. Not just sonically, but sort of vibe-wise too.
Yeah.
So I try not to mess with that too much. That's kind of like changing the color of your mother's eyes. You're going to walk in the room and immediately go, what happened? It's still your mother, but it's something really important that was a touchstone to you. So yes, I help out drum sounds all the time.
Okay.
There's a bunch of really great, so it used to be very hard. There's a bunch of great software now that does it very, very well. And I sneak in stuff behind it. Listen, even on the old Tribe records, when the technology was very, very primitive, a lot of times I would sneak in the attack from a cowbell. So you never heard the conk, you just heard that snap of the attack, and mix it back in underneath the snare, stuff like that, just to make the stuff pop a little bit more.
Uh-huh.
So it's actually better to do that than to run around in circles for a long time trying to draw something out of something that's not even there to begin with. So I've finally gotten a little bit of wisdom where I can suss out real quickly, if it's not there, then I'm gonna have to find something to sneak in behind it and make it appear as if that element is that aggressive.
Uh-huh, it's interesting. So besides just the snare and the kick then, And besides even drums, like how about adding additional sounds?
No.
Even if it's ambient sounds or anything.
No, no. If there are reverbs and delays and ambience that I may add, yeah, sure, that's part of the record. And I may feature an ambience that becomes another player in the picture of the personnel on the record. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes I'll say to people, it sounds like your reverbs are part of the band, like it's another band member because you're adding a whole dimension. And that's partly why I get paid. And not that I'm great, but my job is to suss out what people meant and where they meant to go and try to make that as bold and interesting to listen to as I can. It also very much depends on the artist. Some artists who I've mixed a couple records for, they know what I do and they're real cool. They kind of just give me their stuff and they say, do your thing. And that's nice because they get the best out of me. Some other people are a little more married to the picture that they have put together already. And part of my gig is to fit into whatever emphasis in the slot that they need me. Uh-huh. You know, I'm not here for me. I'm here to help people realize their vision.
Yeah, yeah.
So one size does not fit all. I guess that's the thing.
Okay. So just to get to be very specific, like in the song Can I Kick It, there's that singing in the hook that's very low, kind of behind everything. Was that something that you as the engineer would
never add that.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
No. I wouldn't. That's production.
Okay.
And that's songwriting, when you add musical elements that weren't there.
So never anything, just beef up the kick or snare.
Yeah, I don't add musical parts. And like I said, sometimes I get called and they say, would you do some additional production? I have to say, over the last 25 or 30 years, I found that it never really works. Mm-hmm. You know, because you're putting your sensibility onto somebody else's sensibility, and it often doesn't mesh that well.
Okay.
You know, if you build something up from the beginning, there's a through line to the whole thing creatively.
Yeah.
But no, I do not add musical elements. I can make it seem like there's more musical elements because I'm not, I don't want to use the word amplifying, but I'm clarifying what was there to begin with. Mm-hmm. So I can make people say, oh wow, I never noticed that before. That's really cool. Yeah, that's what I'm supposed to be doing, but that thing was there anyway.
What about, okay, so to build on that, what about turning things off? How often do you have tracks where you're just like, this is just too much, I gotta take this out of the song?
A lot of people, when they talk about mixing, they say the most important thing you have is the mute button. Mm-hmm. And yeah, sometimes in order to build density and excitement and to illustrate the long form arc of the song, I'll end up muting stuff early on in the song and then bringing it in later, even though they might have had it there all the way along. And listen, half the time they go, that was a really cool idea, that's great. And half the time they say, no man, that thing's got to be in there right from the beginning, I meant it to be there. I suffer from assuming that if something is there in the session that the artist and producer made it so you're, wants it to be heard. And I've been wrong, but you know, if something's really too dense right away and the chorus doesn't pay off because the verse was so big to begin with, I may mute some things at the beginning of the verse or at least tone them down a little bit. So by the time the chorus hits, you have some place to go.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so all right, another specific, the Erykah Badu On and On. You co-produced
yes.
and arranged that.
Yeah.
Now, let's go to arranging. How often are you given a song and they have the beat, they have the lyrics, obviously the vocals and whatnot, but it's not really arranged in a way where it's a full song and you actually have to piece
it
together?
That's what, you know, a lot of the better records I've done, they've come in where there's been programming already, there's fleshed out ideas, it just wasn't quite a record.
Uh-huh.
You know, the guys who wrote the song with Erykah, they got a lot of stuff right, you know, and the basic fundamental nature of those sounds, I chased that, I went after that. Mm-hmm. But you also gotta make it bigger and bolder. And there were some samples that we had to replace and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always different, you know. Records are like people, nobody's the same.
Yeah, so when you are arranging and moving stuff around, I guess what, as far as publishing, songwriting credits, how does that
you know what, I've worked with some of the greatest songwriters of our time in their genres. Erica, D'Angelo, Citizen Cope is, I think, an incredible songwriter, one of the great songwriters of our age. I'm not about to kind of come in and say, no, we need to rewrite this song. There's been certain bands where I've said, okay, this hook isn't working. What about something like this? And then, you know, you kind of mold it and then say, I think this is fair if we split it up this way. But I don't like to barge in and just jump on people's publishing right away. Uh-huh. There's a lot of A-list producers that you don't walk in the door unless you split your publishing with them or authorship.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would never have been so presumptuous to do that with the caliber of people I've worked with.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's it's I'm gonna bend over backwards to find out what is super special about what that artist is doing and make it work, rather than saying, this isn't working, we need to change it.
Uh-huh.
That's just my philosophy.
Yeah, well, okay, so to go off that, you don't feel like mixing engineers should get publishing? I mean, and I guess—
No, I don't.
Not at all?
No, I mean, that you know, in Europe, the studio personnel, producer, I'm not sure if mixers, but I know producers and musicians get performance royalties. That's a different story.
Yeah.
NARIS, the Grammy organization, and many people have been lobbying for that for years here, so that the production, all the production personnel, from musician through producer, got performance royalties when that stuff was played for broadcast or narrowcast or streamed or something like that. It's never going to happen, I don't think, here. I just think that people are not going to want to let go of pieces of the pie that they already have just to be good people.
Well, okay, but if you're adding something to the kick and adding something to the snare, aren't you kind of songwriting in a sense?
No.
Okay.
No. Technically, the song is the melody, the words, and the chords that are behind it.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. That's where you stand on it. Interesting.
You know, when I'm producing with people, if I actually add a section or something like that, there have been times where I just haven't wanted to go there because there's been so much other strife. There have been times where it's been like, guys, what do you think about giving me 15% of the song just because of my contribution? And I think there's a way to have that conversation in a reasonable, non-heated way, you know, because people get heated up.
Diplomatic.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but no, I don't, I think writing the song is a very specific thing, and hopefully that will have been done before it gets to me. Now, there's people I co-write with, and that's a totally different thing, as we build something up from the bottom up.
Yeah. Okay, so, so you made a good point in that, a totally different point. Being diplomatic, being a people's person, knowing how to talk to people, especially artists who, you know,
they're artists.
They're artists.
Don't have to say anything else.
Yeah, they're artists.
I mean, it's artists are.
How important are those people skills in this business, besides just the musicality, having a great ear? And,
to me, they're very important. I also know a lot of people who are assholes and work a lot because they're real good.
Mixing engineers?
Yeah. But I think everybody, I think our worth on this planet, when we go, is, you know, how much joy we spread. And that's what I'm here to do. I'm here to help people.
Yeah.
And that's just me. That's, and people sometimes think I'm too much like that, and I don't care, whatever. I think that it's really nice to have really good relationships, respectful, I'll say loving relationships with the people you work with. I mean that in a very broad sense.
Mm-hmm.
That's the payoff to me, is getting to do things in an atmosphere where everybody feels real good about what they're doing because everybody's got the space to contribute what they do and people are respecting that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so let me just take a little turn. Mixing drums. Program drums versus drums that you've actually, or maybe sometimes somebody else recorded them. I'm guessing if you're mixing someone's drums and it's actually recorded, like a real drums, you were the one recording them as well, or have you had those?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay.
If I record, you know, I got my stuff that I do and I know it's going to sound pretty good really fast. That's what I tell my students, is like, people's creative energy on the floor. You know, everyone thinks you can. I used to take a lot of time setting up, getting everything just perfect. I'm like, no, get it going real fast so people don't have to sit around, so they can put their creative energy into the music.
Interesting.
Yeah. Oh man, that's really important. So when I'm mixing stuff that I've cut, 90% of the recorded, 90% of the time, it's great. Mm-hmm. I still make mistakes. The stuff I get from other people, it takes all different forms. It's unfortunate that because the technology has become accessible to everybody, there's not a lot of professional recording engineers around anymore. Like in the 90s, early 2000s, there were people that's all they did.
Yeah.
And they were very good. So I will say that a lot of the stuff I get to mix now, some of it is not recorded very well. Some of it is, you know.
Okay. So whether it's recorded well or not is going to matter. But programmed drums versus recorded drums, do you take a totally different approach?
No.
Mix? No.
I take the approach, what is the song?
Uh-huh.
You know, the song is my true north throughout, before I said artist and producer's vision, but really, as a producer or arranger or mixer, everything I do is dictated by what the song is telling me what to do. You can't say this artist is always like this, because then all the songs will sound the same. The song will always dictate one's approach. I think most people who do what I do will say the same thing.
Uh-huh.
Some songs you immediately say, oh, the drums really want to be hard and muscular on this thing. Some songs you say, wow, the drums need to just provide a stream for everything else to float on, but you don't want to draw attention to it. Mm-hmm. So it's always different.
Yeah, interesting. Okay, so have you ever worked on a project? Let's say a project that you talk about a lot, and I get to most people in hip hop that would say it's a groundbreaking project that changed the game. Low End Theory. When you were making that specific project, did you ever think like, this is absolutely amazing, but people might not catch it? Did you feel that?
I feel that all the time. Okay. You know, honest to God, this sounds like I'm pandering. Like, you know, pay me enough money and I'll love what you do. That, no, I'm not saying it like that. But the reason that people like me and professionals get paid is you are paid to love that thing to death. But in a very real way, you are paid. So that's me. You know, I feel like I get paid so that I very seriously take that song in front of me is the most important thing in the universe.
Uh-huh.
So every record you make, when you're in the middle of the record, generally you're loving it. And if you're not loving it, then you should change it so you do love it. I've given up a long time ago of saying this is going to hit big and this is not, because I'm usually 100% wrong.
Uh-huh. So what, I guess when you were making that then, what were your thoughts on that?
You know,
did
I was trying
was
to
be groundbreaking, or you
facilitate the guy's vision. That's what I was doing on that record as an engineer and mixer. I thought it was very engaging, but you never know, man. You never know. You know, a lot of stuff that I've done that I thought was really good never even got released. So you never know.
Interesting.
You never know. All you can do is, you know, for that song that's in front of you at that moment, make it as interesting to listen to as you can. And that sounds like sort of basic, and it is, but a lot of times, you know, it's like, are you giving people a chance to get bored with this? Because if you are, you better put something in there, and this is an arranging thing, uh-huh. that keeps people's interest going.
Uh-huh.
You know, arranging is very much like mixing, is that you're legislating the level of importance that you want the listener to perceive the different elements. You know, the vocal is almost always up front. You know, that's going to be the thing that people want to perceive on the first level of consciousness. Then usually the rhythm section is right after that in R&B. In rock, it's usually the guitars. But then it goes back, and all these things have to exist simultaneously. But people need to, you need to mix it or arrange it in such a way where it's very.
Rolling. Okay, cool.
Jeez, I have to put my phone away?
All right, so you talked about mixing live drums, you talked about recording. Do you quantize drums and do you quantize performances in general?
No. I don't. When I'm programming, I selectively quantize different elements and I don't quantize them 100% of the way. I don't make them perfect. I make them just feel really good. Here's my dog. I don't know if you guys can see my Doberman's here, but she's probably out of the frame. I have had to cut up people's performances when I'm producing. If someone, if a drummer doesn't cut it, I'm very picky. There's like five drummers in the world I'll call, and that's it. Because, and anybody who produces live music understands that if the drum track is really together, you can do anything and pull it off. If the drum track stinks, you can throw everything in the world at the track and the track will never be happening.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's something called Beat Detective where you can have Pro Tools automatically line up the drums where they're supposed to be. I don't like that. It sounds like a drum machine to me. Mm-hmm. So I end up cutting, you know, sometimes taking days and moving around different hits and stuff like that till it feels really good.
Okay, so you basically manually quantize it.
Yeah, but I don't put it so it's perfect. I put it so it's
just sounds right.
Deep. All the way along.
Okay.
You know, and every drummer in the world is a hit or two that you need to move and stuff. But I, you know, I'm very picky about the drummers I call now. And like I said, everybody is.
Yeah. You know. Yeah. So, okay. I used to be under the impression as a producer that digital, making music digitally, mixing it, mastering it, all that good stuff, is you can get it 98% as good as hardware. Now I'm kind of backing off from that statement. I would like to know your take on that. Do you believe that the difference between hardware and software, the pros and cons, and do you believe that you can get software to sound as good as the hardware?
Yes, and the distance has been diminishing between the two. And over the last 4 or 5 years, it's gotten so that I can mix something and not use my analog hardware at all, and it's really good. I've said for a long time that the digital tools are there. It's up to us to learn how to use them better rather than bitch that it's not this thing, it's not a real 1176. Well, no, it's not, but there's certain things that digital does better.
Mm-hmm. As far as precision, would you
well,
say?
Well, yeah, and you know, anybody who's worked on tape knows this, is that you record your rhythm tracks on the 24-track tape, and you listen to them that day, and the drums have all this snap, crackle, pop. They sound really great, real punchy, a lot of attack. And then by the time the tape has rolled over the heads 2,000 or 3,000 times, because you're doing overdubs, you sit down to mix, and it doesn't sound that good anymore. So the nice thing about digital is you get it in there, and it doesn't change.
Uh-huh.
But only people who've worked on analog and tape a lot understand what I'm talking about.
Yeah, because I don't.
My thing is, yes, use the best analog gear you can to get it in there. But the tools that are inside the box now are really, really cool, and there's a lot of stuff that you could never do outside of the box. I also think that our perception of what is good and what sounds good is colored by years of listening traditions, okay? I don't necessarily think vinyl sounds better or worse than digital. We just got used to listening to vinyl, so it was a very comfortable place. Mm-hmm. You know, in school at NYU, we do a mic shootout, and we put different microphones on all these different instruments, and everybody always thinks the SM57 sounds the best on the snare. It's not because it's the highest Phi thing, it's because that's what we've heard on records for so long.
Yeah.
We say, oh yeah, that's the sound of a snare drum. So I think we've been conditioned to think that certain things sound good.
I agree with that.
So to be objective about that and to be able to manipulate stuff objectively rather than just being a slave to like, well, this is what I'm used to and this is what I think sounds good, so I have to go here all the time. I think that's ridiculous. Again, the song is your guide. The song will always tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. But especially in the last couple of years, digital has really stepped up. The move to 24-bit, and this was probably 8 or 10 years ago, mm-hmm. was huge.
Yeah.
Pro Tools rewrote the audio engine a couple of years ago, so all the DAWs handle audio really pretty well now.
Yeah.
And the plugin manufacturers the last couple of years have gotten really, really good.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm not going to name names, but everybody's doing real, real good work now.
You don't want to name any names?
Well, you know, UA stuff, obviously, everyone says the UA stuff upped the game a lot. Mm-hmm. I love FabFilter. I use my DSP. Yeah. Eventide is making some really cool stuff. Dave Durr, the distressor guy, making something called an arouser. It's a digital form of a distressor. There's so much good stuff out there now. And it's really up to us to use it well. Mm-hmm. You know, I think, like, it's digital and this is all I could do. I think that's bullshit.
Yeah, I agree with that.
You know, when stuff is really poorly recorded, and that's really half my career, is dealing with stuff that wasn't recorded well and making you listen to it in a way where you say, wow, that sounds great. Mm-hmm. You know, not drawing attention away from what the record is doing, but to have it as interesting to listen to it on a purely sonic level as it is on a musical level.
Uh-huh. Okay. I want to ask you, do you have any, so this is off the, Nick, when I interviewed Nick Sasano, he had that pretty amazing story about recording with the Ice Cube's first album in a week and this and that. Do you have a story you'd want to tell that you haven't told yet? Something really fucking cool behind the scenes? If you don't, that's fine. I don't want to push.
There's so much there. I can't really think, you know.
Really?
I can't really. I've told this story a lot where on, I guess it's on either Low in Theory or Midnight Marauders. I can't remember when Tip says, Bob Power, are you there? And I said, yeah. Tip was laying a rhyme down. And after he got done with his take, I said, oh man, you know in that spot where you said, Bob Power, are you there? I should get on the talk back and say, hello, yes? He said, yeah, that's what I meant. You know, it was synchronicity.
And yes.
Because a lot of times when MCs are rapping, if I'm recording, I'm thinking about a lot of things other than what they're saying. Mm-hmm. I'm like trying to keep my shit together. I'm trying to make sure the recording is happening in a really, really good way. Mm-hmm. Paying a lot of attention to that. So a lot of times I'm not really listening. If I'm producing, it's different because I'm really listening to the performance. Mm-hmm. And I've gotten as good enough as an engineer where I can kind of set stuff and not have to worry about the recording end of it. Back in those days, I was still learning a lot, and I was really eagle-eyed and eagle ears all the time, you know, making sure that everything
perfect.
Yeah, it was good enough.
Yeah. What project have you worked on that A was the most fun? Which project was the most difficult? And which one now do you listen to and you're like, damn, that was bad. Bad meaning good. Like that was badass. That was a dope project. Did you have any bad experiences where you're like,
this
sucked?
I've been fired from records. Everybody has.
Wow.
You know, that's the stuff you don't hear about that often.
Even after?
Yeah, after doing a couple tracks, they didn't like what I was doing. That's part of the business.
Was this when you were starting, or after the Tribe album?
No, this is after I was established. I've mixed records that they haven't liked and they've redone it. I've produced records that they haven't liked and they've redone it. Everybody does that. You know? I've been the guy to fix stuff. When they don't like someone else's work, they've called me. Mm-hmm. And I always call that first person and say, listen, man, are you cool with this? You know, and I've had people call me saying, hey, they want me to mix that song you mixed again. Are you okay with it? I'm like, yeah. You know, whatever works for people. You got to get your ego out of it, man.
Yeah, no, agreed.
Back to what I said before about working on a project where everybody feels good about themselves and their contribution to it, that objective of mine has been fashioned by a lot of situations where there was a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. And I'm too old for that shit, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, I want to make sure we're all pointed in the same direction. I'm here to help you, period. I'm not here to be Big Willie. I'm here to help you. And if you can get with that and you want my help, that's great. And if not, you'll be fine anyway. Mm-hmm. But I like to be in a situation where everybody gets to contribute and really the sum comes out much greater than anybody could have done it by themselves. That's the whole idea about working with the team. Mm-hmm. And also, this is really true about production. If a song doesn't start to take a life of its own at a certain point in the production and start to tell you what to do, you know, rather than you saying, what can I do to make this cooler here or this or that, there's a certain point at which the song becomes a living, breathing thing, and it's different than what you had in your head. And if it doesn't do that, it's not happening. It's going to be boring, I guarantee you. If a song comes out exactly the way you had it in your head, at least my experience is, it's boring as hell. There's songs are like children, you know. You need to give them room to sort of start to develop a character of their own and be sharp enough to say, wow, that's a really cool thing about this that I never thought about before. Let's exploit that, you know.
Yeah.
So that's nirvana in record making, is when you get to the point where the song starts to inform you rather than you pushing the song around. And you know this, and anybody who makes records knows this.
Yeah.
That there's a point at which the song really comes alive and you don't have to push it around anymore.
Yeah, yeah, that's an awesome feeling. Okay, so you started off as playing guitar.
Yeah.
When did you first start listening to rap? And did you ever think that you'd become, obviously you've done, like you said, you've done jazz, done a lot of R&B, but I feel like, maybe it's just because I'm a hip-hop guy at heart, I feel like the hip-hop community has put you in a certain place that maybe other genres haven't, and we kind of look at you as I don't know what term to use, but definitely a legend. Did you ever think when you were younger, being this guitar player from Westchester, that you were going to be this legend in hip-hop?
Hip-hop didn't exist when I started. You know, I'd been already playing music for 20 years before hip-hop came along.
That's crazy.
You know, I started playing guitar in the 60s, man. So, you know, and honestly, and I've said this before a lot, when I was working at Calliope and I was kind of a freelance staff guy there, and hip-hop people started coming through the door, all I cared about was, wow, these are really nice people. They're real cool. But, you know, I just didn't, I mean, I've done it, but I didn't attract heavy drug crews or heavy violence crews or heavy gun crews. I just did my karma, man. People who I came into contact with, for the most part, were really, really good people. And they came through the door and I was like, wow, this is interesting. They dress and talk different. And the challenges of making hip hop records back then, the technical challenges were so great.
What were some of those challenges?
Oh my God, samplers had 3/4 of a second of sample time.
Yeah.
So if you listen to the sound of hip hop records over the years, and they really started out without samplers with the DJ, that the evolution of samplers and increased sampling time led to more complex constructions. And that's why the low end theory, the first couple of Tribe records, and Prince Paul and Paz and De La and Large Professor and Pete Rock. And as sampling time got better and better, the constructions were much more than, oh, there's a sampled piece of a beat and that's it.
So
that those technical advances really helped the art form move along. When hip hop first came through the door, look, I've been playing in black bands all my life, you know, and I was in the jazz community as well. So what came through the door was kids, and this was real interesting because jazz and sort of R&B stuff, I'd done it all. And I was used to that, and I was used to that way of talking and making music. These kids came through the door, they dressed differently, they talked differently, and even sometimes they walked differently.
Yeah.
You know, and I say that in a very embracing way.
Yeah.
And I just thought, wow, this is interesting. You know.
And right away you gravitated towards it?
Yeah, it's not that I thought it was good or bad. I was like, these are really nice people, and this is real interesting, and there's some interesting challenges about making this work. So, you know, I'm down. I happen to have worked with some really, really great people. And again, there weren't a lot of knuckleheads. I mean, there have been, but most of the people that I've gotten together with from the hip-hop world have been really intelligent, compassionate, incredibly talented people. So that was the thing to me, and I wasn't like, oh, it's hip-hop, so it's different. It's like, whatever, man, it's all music.
It was Stetsasonic that your first like big hip-hop group that you
yeah,
worked with? That was
yeah,
your, that
yeah.
was your foot in the door?
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, a lot of that was Prince Paul. A lot of that was Daddy-O. People sleep on Daddy-O. Daddy-O was a creative, really
genius,
really interesting creative force. I haven't seen him in some time, but he was way ahead of the curve on many, many things, I thought.
Uh-huh.
And Paul was a big part of that as well. But that was a cooperative band to a certain degree.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that was the first time. And I never sat down and said, what do I have to do sonically with this music so it'll fit in with everything else that's happening? It was a very natural thing to mix the drums so big on the bottom and really forward in the mix. I don't, for some reason, it just worked for me. possibly because I've been playing R&B most of my life, and R&B is, you know, the pocket and the groove is everything, and in hip hop, the drums were usually most of what was defining that pocket and groove. It's the drums and the MC.
Yeah.
So it was like, oh yeah, this is music. Mm-hmm. You know, they're making it differently and they're going about it differently, but it's just music like everything else.
It came real natural.
Yeah. I played in a lot of R&B bands, so under all sorts of different circumstances, people throwing shit at the stage, big fights, you know, hide under the tables, you know, the whole deal.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, I could say as a fan, I could hear that it's natural to you, you know. I appreciate, and I speak for a lot of people, I appreciate what you've done for the culture. It's always cool, the thing about hip hop, how, you know, the roots of it are very black, but it's just embracing and a lot of people, it's kind of like if you have something to add on, that was a word that, you know, I'm sure you heard that word back in the day, is add on. If you have something to add to the culture, it's always been very much like, okay, let's see what you can add, and you definitely added a lot, and I speak for a lot of people when I say thank you.
Well, thank you.
I appreciate you doing this interview. I wanted to ask you one last question.
Let me just speak to that for
a second.
Sure. I think humanistic values, if we're going to survive, and this is a very heavy time to be bringing that into the conversation, but positive humanistic values are absolutely the most important thing we have as a culture. And by culture, I mean the world.
Mm-hmm.
So my thing about hip hop was like, wow, these are really nice people. They're really cool. They're approaching something in a really different, really interesting way. Let me try to engage with that. So it wasn't that it was hip hop and it was different or it was this or that. I saw it as just one big thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, wanting to help people realize their vision was the thing that always drove me. And again, most of the time, you know, if I worked with knuckleheads, I usually didn't stick with them for that long. So, you know, it was about a fundamental humanism. So it wasn't a black thing or a white thing. It was a people thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's really important to me.
Yeah, that's dope. I had a question. There was because I'm like a historian, a hip hop nerd. There was a person named Paul C. Do you know who that, have you ever crossed paths with him?
I'm sure I have, and I know that name, and I'm trying to remember what the context was.
He was just a random white dude from Queens, but he taught Large Professor how to produce.
Really? Wow.
He produced a lot of Eric B. and Rakim, the second album. He produced a lot of Organized Confusion, Ultramagnetic MCs.
Really?
Yeah.
The Ultramags were great.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were really cool.
Yeah.
And they had a couple big records, which is nice.
Yeah, definitely. So I thought maybe if you knew, you might have crossed paths. Or not.
I probably did. There's just so many people. A lot of times somebody walks in the studio and say, Bob. And I'm like, hi. Oh, yeah. I mean, you
yeah,
know,
like today when I shook
your hand. The past 40 years is kind of a blur.
Yeah.
And I just see myself standing over a console twisting knobs or being on a bandstand playing chords or something, but it's kind of like a montage in a film where I have all these little scenes drifting around and dissolving in and out of each other, but the specifics of them, I don't actually care. Because ladies first, you don't stop. Until the JBs, you don't stop. And they lost soul, you don't stop. Until my brand new beginning.